World Space Week runs from the 4th to the 10th of October. This is something that was instituted by the UN as a way of recognising and celebrating the contribution of space science to our everyday lives. And actually, although it's not well known, this is an area that ABB has been deeply involved in for some time. To find out a bit more about those projects, I'm delighted to say I'm joined by Frederic Grandmont from our measurement and analytics team in Quebec. Frederic, thanks for taking the time to talk to us in the studio today. Can you just give me a bit of an overview of ABB's involvement in space science?
So ABB is a specialist in optical sensors, among other things. And there's a subgroup of ABB in these optical sensors that is the specialist of optical sensors in space. So we have a number of instruments that are flying on satellites around the Earth, making measurement about the atmosphere, the Earth's surface, and contributing very, very unique measurement to our knowledge of how the climate evolves, how temperature change, and things like that. So space science in the sense of understanding the atmosphere, weather pattern, these kind of things.
You mentioned climate science there. I know this is a big area for the climate. So what kind of contribution does space technology play in addressing these climate goals?
There's two main areas where people, you know, still work actively in the science field. One is understanding, you know, to what extent does temperature on the Earth rise? So it's basically trying to make the most comprehensive measurement of the Earth temperature that involves the Earth's surface, but also the various layers of the atmosphere. It's not only just the Earth's surface that increases in temperature, it's also the atmosphere. So making these measurements, very precise measurements of the temperature and having a global distribution, not just focusing on one spot because something else, you know, might be happening somewhere else and then just getting a very global average. But then also understanding, you know, where does that come from? And as we all know, greenhouse gas play a very, very strong role in there. So understanding where the greenhouse gas are being emitted, how do they migrate up in the atmosphere, that kind of thing. And so this is more in the cause than just observing the end phenomenon. So we work on both aspects with two types of instrument.
When we talk about greenhouse gases, we're talking about things like methane?
We're talking methane, we're talking CO2. The methane is somewhat easier to spot from space. There's a lot less resident methane in our atmosphere than there is CO2. If you remember your classes, you'd say the atmosphere composed of, you know, nitrogen, oxygen, and then CO2. And then methane is just a very tiny fraction. So once you're in space, you see resident methane and resident CO2 all the way around the globe. But if there's a strong emitter, it'll show more nicely in the methane than it shows on the CO2, because in the CO2, it's kind of buried under a layer of CO2 that's already present. But in methane, it's very striking. So the methane is quite easy to spot from space. We see the CO2, but we just typically see the global average of CO2. And then if the source is very strong, we'll spot like a bump in the overall average of CO2 as well.
You talk about how some of these gases are quite hard to spot. I mean, space is a big place, I understand. How difficult is it to actually find the substances we're trying to measure, and how accurate are we talking about when we look at these instruments?
So typically what you would like to have, if you had, you know, all powers, you would like to fly a drone through the atmosphere, you know, collect some samples and try to figure out what's the composition of the atmosphere and see, you know, where there's more CO2 and less. That's very difficult, very expensive. What we do typically is we sit in space and we look at the sun that shines on the Earth's surface and back into the space. And in pretty much the same way that different humans have different DNA, you know, the genes, we can read the DNA of matter through spectroscopy. So that means molecules leave an imprint on the light that, you know, either reflect off these molecules or transmit through these molecules. They leave an imprint that is very, very unique to the molecules in question. So we, with the help of scientists, have trained our instrument to look for the signature of CO2 or the signature of methane in the sunlight that gets reflected off the surface of the Earth, or the emission that comes directly from the Earth, because, you know, the Earth is warm, and in the infrared, pretty much like, you know, in hunting, people can have like infrared goggles and see, you know, animal being bright in the landscape. The Earth is bright in space. It's like a warm body, and it emits its own light. And then we can also work in these conditions to observe the fingerprints of these molecules.
Looking beyond climate science, do we have any involvement in kind of space exploration projects, things of that sort?
Yeah, being experts in the field of space instrument gives us access to responding to RFPs for other types of space instrument. We have delivered a very, very sensitive camera to NASA to fly on their next space telescope. So people are aware of the James Webb Space Telescope that went on the news for quite some time. There's another one that's coming that's called the Roman Space Telescope. And this telescope will be equipped with a camera, a very specialized camera, that allows to block starlight in order to reveal the surrounding of the starlight to look for a planet, because these planets are so dim compared to the starlight. And so we built for NASA two specialized cameras, actually one of the most sensitive cameras that will have been flown by NASA when it launched in 2028. And these cameras will be attempting to make these pictures of exoplanets around other stars and potentially revealing the chemical composition through the same technique, the spectroscopy, being able to know what kind of molecules are these planets made of and potentially revealing signs of life.
Wow, so ABB technology involved in the hunt for planets beyond our solar system. That's incredible. What kind of developments do you see in this sector now, looking ahead? I know there's been a lot of R&D in this area. When you look forward, where do you see the next big changes, the big jumps coming?
So the when we look at the history of space instrument and so on, this was mostly a domain that was controlled by governments and big space agencies like NASA, European Space Agencies, and other. We see a big boom now in the commercial sector trying to benefit from these developments, but using these technologies to make civil-oriented measurement. A little bit like, GPS started to be something for the military and then transitioned into our everyday life. And now, you know, any sports requires access to GPS data if you do outdoor sports and so on. So companies are starting to fly constellations of payload that are looking at the Earth and trying to digitize the surface of the Earth, a bit like, let's say, Google Map, but something that would have a much more frequent refresh rate from which you could infer actionable data. And this is an area that we see is shaping up and will undoubtedly be part of the future, our future.
Frederic, thanks so much for the time to explain those projects to us today. Frederic Grandmont talking to me there from our site in Quebec. And for more about our involvement in World Space Week and on our measurement and analytics technologies, keep an eye on our social media channels and our website, abb.com.